Hello and welcome to my talk about confidential virtual machines with AMD SCVES and OpenSUSE Tumbleweed. My name is Jörg Rödel and I work for SUSE as a Linux kernel and virtualization engineer. So let's get started. So first of all, what is confidential computing? So when you want to keep your data confidential, you usually encrypt it. There's lots of technology already for this. So for example, while your data is in transit, you can use network encryption with TLS or VPNs, for example. When you want to encrypt your data while you save it on disk, basically when your data is on rest, you use disk encryption. For example, DMCrypt or any other related technologies you can use. The only thing that was missing so far was encrypting your data while it is processed on the CPU, because to process your data, you have to encrypt it and you have to process the raw data on the CPU. This is where confidential computing comes into the picture. Several hardware vendors came up with hardware extensions which allow you to encrypt your data while it is processed on the CPU. For example, AMD SEV or Intel SGX or Intel TDX. There's more from IBM and ARM. In this talk, we will focus on AMD SEV. So what is AMD SEV? SEV is short for Secure Encrypted Virtualization. So you can basically encrypt your virtual machines. And it looks like this. So with legacy virtualization, you have your physical machine, your host machine with a hypervisor running on it, and you have your virtual machines running. And some of your virtual machines might contain confidential data like credit card numbers, certificates, private keys, anything like that, passwords. And of course, you want to keep that data confidential and no one should ever be able to read or steal that data. Problem is, with legacy virtualization, the hypervisor can see all of the guest memory. It can see what the guest is doing and it can copy out the data as it wants. So the hypervisor can steal any data that is in guest memory and the guest will not even notice it. With secure encrypted virtualization, you can start an encrypted virtual machine, which basically turns the virtual machine into a black box. All guest memory is encrypted by default, and the hypervisor is no longer able to read it. When it tries to read, it will only see the encrypted data, and it cannot longer make any sense of it. So most of the guest memory is encrypted, except for small parts, which are used and required for the guest to actually communicate with the hypervisor. This memory is, for example, used for DMA buffers and other shared data structures. Which memory is not encrypted is under control of the guest. So the guest has full control over which memory is encrypted and which is not. And also important, you can run your encrypted virtual machines alongside legacy virtual machines. So there's no need to have all virtual machines on your host encrypted. You can just encrypt the machines which really need it, which really have the confidential data in them. So that was SEV, encrypted guest memory, and the extension of that is SEVES, encrypted state. With encrypted state, not only the guest memory is encrypted, but also the guest register state. That is important because the guest register state can also contain confidential data. For example, you can have AES keys in the FPU state or other confidential data in other registers. So that needs to be protected as well from the hypervisor. And this is achieved with SEVES. But this creates some problems for the hypervisor because for the hypervisor to handle intercepts of the guest, it needs access to the register state. For example, some instructions which cause intercepts, like CPU ID or read and write MSR, take their parameters and registers. And when the hypervisor has no access to those registers, it can't emulate those instructions. So how does that work with SEVES? Under SEVES, most intercepts of the guest, which would hand control back to the hypervisor, are not actually intercepts anymore, but they are turned into exceptions, which are delivered inside the guest. So there is a new exception vector, the VC exception, vector 29, which is raised inside the guest on most intercept events. So the guest has to implement a handler for the VC exception, and inside handler, it has to implement a paravirtualized protocol to talk to the hypervisor to actually handle the request or handle the intercept. And the paravirtual interface uses a shared data structure called the guest hypervisor control block, or GHCB in short. And the guest only puts the information into the GHCB, which the hypervisor needs to handle the intercept. For example, if it's a CPU ID intercept, it will only put the ECX register and probably the XCR1 register into the GHCB, and not all other register state, like the instruction pointer or stack pointer or anything like that. So the hypervisor only gets the information it needs to actually handle the request. How does it look like? It's a simple flow diagram. So let's have a guest which has its execution flow, and somewhere in its execution flow there's a CPU ID instruction. CPU ID is usually intercepted by the hypervisor, so the CPU notices it and will not hand control back to the hypervisor as it would do for a legacy guest, but it raises a VC exception inside the guest. So in the guest, the VC handler starts executing. The VC handler finds out that it was triggered by a CPU ID instruction and prepares the GHCB data structure with the necessary information and issues a VMG exit instruction. The VMG exit instruction is the hypercall instruction for SCVES guests. And on a VMG exit, the CPU will do a real VM exit. So it will hand control back to the hypervisor. But before it does so, it takes the guest register state, encrypts it, and stores it into the VMSA, and restores hypervisor register state and starts executing. So now the hypervisor is executing. The hypervisor sees that there was a VMG exit intercept, and it looks into the GHCB to find out which event it needs to be handled. Then it handles that event, in this case CPU ID, and fills the values for the requested function into the GHCB. And when it's done, it returns to the guest by executing a VM run instruction. On VM run, the CPU will load and decrypt the register state of the guest from the VMSA. And then the guest continues executing right after the VMG exit instruction. Which means in the VC handler, and the VC handler will evaluate the contents of the GHCB, which was written by the hypervisor, and updates its own register state and returns to the original execution flow, which triggers the CPU ID intercept. So this is how things work with SCVES. How is SCVES currently supported? So SCVES is fully supported in all necessary upstream projects. It is supported in QEMU since version 6.0, which was released on April 29, 2021. It's fully supported in OVMF, which is the EFI BIOS needed for SCVES guests. It's fully supported in the Linux kernel, where the guest support landed in kernel 5.10, so kernel 5.10 onwards can run as an SCVES guest. And Linux has the ability to run SCVES guests since kernel 5.11, which means that OpenSUSE Tumbleweed has now full support for running SCVES guests since around mid-May 2021. It can run as an SCVES guest for even longer, but since mid-May it has full support and can even run SCVES guests. And in addition to that, SUSE Linux Enterprise Server 15SP3, and with that also OpenSUSE Leap 15.3, come with full SCVES guest support, so you can run these distributions as SCVES guests. What do you need to run SEV ES guests or SEV guests? In short, you need AMD EPYC processors. The first generation, the Naples processors, have full support for secure encrypted virtualization. They also have support for encrypted state, but that might cause some problems. So if you want that more stable, you use the second generation, the Rome generation of the EPYC processors. Those have full support for SEV ES. And if you even have the third generation, which was launched this year, then you have also support for secure nested paging, which we are currently about to enable. So support for that is not yet upstream. So now I have prepared a short demo. To show you how you can run an SEV ES guest under OpenSUSE Tumbleweed. So we have here a Tumbleweed host, and I prepared a QMU command line to show you how it needs to look like for an SEV ES guest. So this is a QMU command line which launches an SEV ES guest. A standard QMU which has to run is root. That's because QMU has to access device files which are only accessible by root to talk to the platform security processor, which is needed to launch SEV and SEV ES guests. And this file is only accessible by root, so QMU has to run as root for now. Our guest gets an EPYC processor. We emulate an EPYC processor with 4 cores, 4 GB of RAM. Currently, there is no support for rebooting SEV ES guests. It gets a standard VGA interface. The serial port goes to STDIO, an insecure VNC connection. This one is unencrypted and unprotected, so you shouldn't use that in production. But for demo, it's okay. And here it gets interesting. The next 2 lines make the guest an SEV ES guest. So this line contains the configuration of the guest. So we want an SEV guest. The configuration has the ID SCV0, and the important part is the policy. With the policy, we can enable and disable certain SCV features. The policy is a bitmap where every bit can enable a specific feature of SCV. For SCV ES, we have to set bit number 2 in the policy, which makes our policy have the value 4. If we would set policy to 0, we would have a plain SCV guest without SCV ES. Then we have to set the CBIT position. The CBIT position is the bit position in the page table which contains the CBIT, and the CBIT in the page table indicates whether a page points to encrypted memory or not. Page 47 is a physical address bit, so we have also reduced the physical address size of the guest by 1 bit. And the next line actually enables the memory encryption for the guest using the SCV0 configuration, so the configuration which was just specified a line above. So this makes the guest an SCV ES guest. And the next 2 lines are equally important. They configure the guest to use the OVMF EFI BIOS. That's important because the OVMF BIOS is the only BIOS which supports launching SEV ES general purpose guests. So you have to use OVMF. You can't use CBIOS or any other BIOS to launch general purpose Linux guests under SEV ES. So here we have the OVMF binary, and we have storage for the EFI variables, which here is snapshot, so all changes will be lost after the guest exits. If you want your changes to be persistent, you make a copy of this file and point this entry to it and remove the snapshot, and then the changes to your EFI variables will stay persistent. So the next line adds a standard Ethernet controller, and the last 3 lines add a disk image to the guest. Important here is that the interface to the disk image is a VirtIO1, in this case VirtIO SCSI PCI, And for all other I/O devices which you attach to SCV or SCVE as guests, you need to specify IOMMU platform equals on. Otherwise, the guest with I/O drivers will assume that the hypervisor can write to all of guest memory, which is of course not true for SCV and SCVE as guests, because most of guest memory is encrypted and the hypervisor can't just write to it. The hypervisor has to write to the specific areas which the guest mapped unencrypted. And to make the VIRT.io drivers of the guest do that, they have to use the guest DMA API. And for that, you have to specify IOMMU platform equals on. Otherwise, your VIRT.io devices will not work in Linux under SCV and SCVES. Okay, now let's run that. It takes a short moment for the memory to be pinned. Then we can switch to the guest console, to the VGA console. So the guest is booting up. And we see it, the graphical interface comes up. So the guest booted successfully. Now we can check whether it's an SCV ES guest or an SCV guest. The easiest way to do this is checking DMASC. So we look what's there. So we see that the kernel has detected that SCV is active and SCVES is active. So we are running an SCVES guest. So we know our guest memory is encrypted and the guest register state is encrypted. So yeah, so this is how you launch an SCVES guest under Linux today. This opens with a tumbleweed, so you can also use leap 15.3 as a guest, for example. Yeah. So that's what you can do today, and but that's not the end of the story. There's more to come. So we are currently working on, or mostly AMD is working on, with some help from SUSE, on enabling secure nested paging. Secure nested paging will further enhance the protection of the guest by adding protection against memory remapping and memory replay attacks, which the hypervisor can do against the guest. But with SCV SNP, this is no longer possible because that feature introduces an ownership model of memory. So every page is either owned by the hypervisor, owned by the guest, or shared between guest and host. So, and the hardware enforces that. So if the guest maps a hypervisor page encrypted, there will be an error. If the hypervisor tries to access a guest-owned page, there will be an error. Yeah, so the hardware enforces that. That is what currently being worked on to enable it. Next item is interrupt security. Currently, the hypervisor can inject all kinds of events into the guest, which are interrupts or exceptions. Even when the guest is not expecting them, so when the guest has disabled interrupts, for example, the hypervisor is free to accept and to inject an interrupt anyway, which of course is a security problem for guests. So with interrupt security, all the hypervisor can inject is a special event, which the guest is prepared for, that it can be raised at any time. So there's no problem there, and that is, and alongside that event, there's another shared data structure which contains the information about which event is about to be injected, and then the guest can deliver this event by itself when it is ready to do so. For example, NMIs or interrupts. So the guest can then decide when to deliver those. Next item is CPU ID security. Currently, the CPU ID values which the guest gets are from the hypervisor. So those are basically untrusted because the hypervisor is untrusted. With CPU ID security, those CPU ID values will become trusted again because the hypervisor will prepare a page for the guest with a data structure which contains the CPU ID values for most functions. And then the data structure is validated by the platform security processor. The platform security processor is trusted by the guest. It is part of the trusted base. And then the CPU ID page can also be trusted by the guest. And the guest has trusted CPU ID values. And another important part is trusted device drivers, because device drivers in guests usually talk to emulated devices, and those emulated devices are part of the hypervisor, and thus those are untrusted. So the device drivers pose another interface from the guest to the host and need to be hardened against malicious input. There are several approaches to make device drivers more stable and trusted. One is to use fuzzing. There are several projects which implement device driver fuzzing, but nothing which can be used upstream yet. So, and another approach here is to use static analysis. There are also some interesting approaches there to do static analysis of guest device drivers. So we will see what we will end up with, but bottom line is that we need to harden the device drivers used inside guests to make the guest more secure. So this was my talk about SCV and SCVES under OpenSUSE Tumbleweed. I hope you enjoyed it and you can try it out. Thanks for listening, and I'm around for your questions now. Thank you.